Folks, it's such a pleasure and a privilege to be sitting down with all of you today to talk about those extraordinary films and shows that you made this year. They were respite, they were food for thought, they were cathartic, and in some cases, they were an escape for all of us. So thank you for that, and welcome to the Storytellers Roundtable of 2023. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajiv.
So what quality, above everything else, must a good director possess?
I think managing people. I think you need to be a very good manager. You need to create a very good atmosphere for whichever faculty you're working with, so they feel good about giving you their best. Right. You know, I think that it's extremely important you know how to handle your people. My job is actually to manage people on set.
Right.
I don't do much. I just manage people. And I help them, or not help is kind of patronizing, but I work with them to
get
do
their
what they
best,
do best,
right?
Yeah.
Whoever, yeah. Any department.
And that's my job. Yeah. That's my responsibility, actually.
Yeah. I think that's about 80% of the job in any case, yeah. I think.
I would also add you need
I think the other one is maybe having focus and a clarity of what you set out to do before you started the film. You know, before you started the show or a film, I think that's very important, because along the way, you're going to meet so many creative people with so many creative ideas in their own departments that it could end up in a different, it could end up going in a slightly different way. And at the end of it, you're the one left holding the pieces and you realize, oh, I was heading this way. I don't know when it went this way. So I think that focus while getting the best out of everybody so that you're still headed exactly where you want to do, where you want to go. Yeah. I think that's the other most important.
Yeah, I think also, you know, that it's an understanding, a clear understanding of what the underlying, you know, themes are and what the material is really about. Because that's essentially what kind of unites all these different competencies. You know, there's the text, there's the locations, there's all that, but what is it really about? Because that's going to determine sort of what your answers are and help you kind of make everyone make the same show or film or the same piece ultimately.
I think also perseverance. You know, you have to persevere. You have to know that, you know, this, because when you begin the first day, especially when you're making a show. So I remember when we started Scoop, they said, okay, we have 459 pages to go after day one. And so you know, taking each day as it comes, persevering and enjoying each day, you know, going there every day and ensuring that everybody who's working with you is enjoying it as much as you do. You know, so that, I think that patience, that perseverance, and right up to the end, from the time you pitch the show, from the time, you know, you deal with the platform, when your edits go, the notes are given to you, you don't lose your cool. You try to see people's perspectives as much as possible. And then find that sweet spot where you put your foot down, that, okay, this is...
Yeah, this much and no more.
This much and no more, and that, you know, you have to protect. You have to be protective. Yeah. You have to protect what you have made.
Right.
You know, you're basically the custodian of so many efforts coming together to tell this story that you feel so strongly about. So I think you also, it's a child. You have to protect it, nurture it as much as you can.
I guess you also have to be a decision maker. Good or bad, but you have to...
take a stand.
Yeah, take a stand. No, because you're like... 250, 300 people waiting for you to take a call on something. And you may not know creatively whether you are right or wrong, but you need to have that ability that, okay, this is what I'm going for. And then stand by it. That's very important. Otherwise, if you are directionless, then you are not a director.
Yeah.
I think some kind of talent.
Yeah. Yes.
No, I'm saying some knowledge about different technical aspects that you are
right.
on. Because I don't think you should be dependent completely on everything. You need to know what they're doing, and to be even be able to appreciate what they're doing, you need to know those things.
Those things yourself,
I feel like when somebody says, I don't sit on the edit, or I don't know what the lenses are, you know, stuff like that, I think all these things make sense because you can get better out of them too.
Yeah.
And it's really I think I feel one of my jobs is to mine the best from people, because everybody has something to offer. You know, if you have to listen, take what you want from the actors, from the crew. There's a lot to do it. But have the big picture in mind.
Yeah.
I think the big picture is the biggest part for a director, because you're shooting so out of sequence, so minutely, such pieces that the big picture, if somehow you can retain it, you have a big visual, I guess. So,
also fascination. I think I go every day, I still find it magical.
Yeah.
It's 30 years and it never seems ceases to amaze me. You know, every day when something comes out, you know, it's really, really that love for the magical power of storytelling. I think, you know, it's not a very abstract thing, actually.
Yeah.
It's really that amazement when you see something unfolding in front of you. I really feel blessed.
Blessed, yeah.
And you say that, as you say that, because being ex-engineers,
yeah.
I think it's one of, I can't think of another job where the job satisfaction is great all of us sitting.
Yeah.
You know, usually you ask another person and doing a different job, they'll be like, I don't know if I like my job, I want something else.
Right.
I think none of us want to lose our jobs.
I mean, you know, I agree actually with, it's fun listening to these guys because also they've done like many films and long format and I haven't really so much. But still I can relate to what, you know, you guys are saying. Also, there's so many different people on set and, you know, everyone doesn't respond in similar ways. You know, with some people you have to be, you know, maybe a little more, you're coaxing. With some people you have to be a little, you know, pushing them.
So you're constantly changing.
That's also interesting, you know, to adapt. And as an actor, one has adapted to different styles of direction.
Right.
So that, I think that managing people is an important aspect. And also that, you know, preserving, protecting your vision. So, you know, just to remember that initial feeling, oh, I wanted to share this. This was what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And then keep all the other things away. Aside. I agree with that, yeah. Okay.
I mean, I've never directed anything, so I can't speak for a director, but I can tell you what you're doing.
A storyteller, yeah.
You know, but I think your job is to take in inputs from everybody and still do your thing.
Mm.
It's really that, you know, modify your thing from what input you're getting, but still do your thing. And I think that's really, that's how I look at it, you know.
Sure. You know, to all of you, when you start a new project, how are you typically feeling? Is it a surge of confidence? Or is it fear and anxiety?
It's a mix. It's also, for me, it's a bit schizophrenic. So one day I feel like, okay, this is the best thing that I'm doing. And next day you're like, oh man, what am I doing? Why did I say yes to this? Oh shit, can I still back off? Can I call Netflix and say, hang on, I don't think it's a good idea to do this. So it's a, you know, it really changes with, and changes day to day, you know, on bad days on the set, you know, you are like, you know, that's it. You know, that's it. My career is over. I'm not doing anything again. And on good days, you're feeling like, okay, you're making something really special, which again might not be true to, you know, the next day. So it's really like that.
And what is the first day? First day of prep is great.
Yeah.
First day of shoot is like, okay, you know, it depends.
Yeah.
Well, I remember, you know, Randeep told me about something and, you know, that moment that Prashant and he shared on Trial by Fire when the car stopped on the first day of the shoot and Prashant tells him, should we get out or should we just wait a little, man? Because once we get out, it's all madness from here, right?
Yeah, it's like, we can just drive on, you know? We don't have to get out.
Forget the whole thing.
We just go back to the hotel, you know, take a nice spa.
I usually take a difficult scene. I begin with a difficult scene.
Interesting.
So once I cross that barrier, you know, I pick up a difficult scene, it takes time, the actors are slightly unsettled. I like to be, we go in unsettled and I want people to be more unsettled.
Interesting.
Because I believe that this is the most unsettled you will be.
Mm.
And once you have come out of that, you know, and I always tell them that, you know, if it doesn't work, we'll do it again.
Yeah, right. Mm.
But we do that. We sort of try to get into that one tough moment. I always, when my first AD, I tell him, you know, he knows the first day is going to be tough.
Right.
But moment you cross that first scene, and then you start feeling a little more in control of, otherwise you, you know, when you do easy things, you know, you go in and say, he walks in, looks on the right, looks on the left. You don't really feel much in control that, you know, when that big scene comes, you're still, so it's a method that I've picked up, you know, so everything, the cameraman, everybody's sort of trying to get the most out of that one scene.
Right, right.
Day one always begins with a lot of excitement for everyone. Mm. But yeah, it's a new project, let's do this and we'll rock. And but I think there is always a nervousness, you know, inside that you don't know exactly how it's going to pan out. But it's like you know, a batsman going to the pitch, you know, and facing the first few balls. You know, and once you have kind of got used to the pace and bounce, then you know that, okay, you can hang in there. So it's just about those first few scenes, as Moza was saying that. Yeah. Then you kind of calm down.
Not the World Cup finals.
But I mean, if we had the budgets, I'm sure all of us would love to reshoot day one. You know, because that's the feeling I always have. Like, okay, it wasn't bad, but I wish I could reshoot.
But it's a cheat I do.
Yeah, that's what you're saying. It's a cheat in my schedule.
I always have that extra day.
This is good to know.
You know, it is, because I'll tell you what actors say, and I'm sure you know this. I speak to actors and they say, it always takes them at least a few days to find that character. It always takes them a few days. So do directors have the same luxury?
Yeah, and if you're working with a new crew, and even if you're working with the same crew, like, you, nobody's in sync really in the beginning. You know, you don't know how long things are going to take, you know, the shot design. So that first 2, even 3 days, you know, you're still finding each other and finding your rhythm.
Yeah.
So yeah, if anyone offered me the chance to reshoot the first day, I think I'm going to do what you
yeah, always do that.
So throw them budget, in the deep end.
No, and you also budget. Right. You budget for that extra. I budget for 2 extra days.
Wo budget hota hai sir, wo idhar udhar chala jata. At the end of it, you're like, some screw up or the other is taken.
I anyway don't get enough money. So, wo utne mein hi ho jata hai.
Does anyone get it?
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't think anyone's going to say. Yeah. Not even Rajan DK.
It's always 15% less than what we wanted. Like, yeah. You start there and be like, oh no, we have to cut this
very
down.
Very greedy. So.
Sorry,
carry on.
I don't know what I was saying. I was saying that I think first days is the most prepared for us.
Right.
This is the only time DK and I are sitting and making shots, which we never do later. First day only. Like shots, and we draw diagrams, and DK will have a new book, and we'll do it in the car together. Like sit and call the, you know, the whole HODs, everybody's in it. And we're explaining shot one, shot two, all these.
And we have these rules, we print it and put it in front of the monitor. So we put times for each shot, so you're hitting it, and yeah, like, and it lasts for about 2 or 3 hours.
It's fascinating, you know?
It lasts for like half a day by lunch. Yeah. Nobody knows
what. By lunch, nobody's like, fascinating.
Who well prepared for this?
It's fascinating to have two
directors. It's an indie mentality.
You know, two directors working together. After Abbas Mastani, Raj and DK.
No, I think that's what it is. Two people doing it together.
It's fascinating, you know, how you guys managed to work together.
21 years now.
Yeah.
15, I thought.
Oh,
20. Yeah, sure. We know each other for a while.
Right.
Shorts and all. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Depending on where we're counting.
Yeah. Like, it'll be 15 years in the industry next year.
Wow. Yeah. Right? Depending on where we first held hands.
Yeah. But yeah, I also noticed that we lately, it's not something consciously we did, but now I realize in the last 3 shows that we've done, the first day or the first set of days, day one, day two, day three, day four, if it's a sequence, we have happened to have chosen the most difficult thing to shoot. Oh. I don't know why we did that. We picked this one that we were shooting last series, which was Citadel, India. The first 4 days were an intense action sequence.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. I think that gets it out of the way. Yeah. When you start like that, it's all an easy ride from
literally
there
throw them in the deep end.
Yeah.
Sometimes you don't have a choice, you know.
Yeah, like, it's location.
Because of actor dates, location, then you have to shoot this on the first
because,
day. Okay.
The show was called Kora, we needed fog, and we started shooting like at the fag end of February, fag end of the winter. And we started with the first 4 days of the shoot was the 2 days of like the opening sequence and the climax. So we shot the opening sequence, we shot the climax, then shot the rest of the show, which is like I wouldn't advise it because we're shooting the climax, you're like, is it okay? I don't know, man. I don't know what the rest of the show is like, you know?
But it was great.
Let's move on.
I love.
But you know what? You should never decide that I'm not going to do this right at the beginning because that's exactly what you'll end up doing. Right. Every time I've said I will not shoot the climax in the beginning, every time I had to shoot the climax in the beginning. Even including Janeja.
Some kind of Murphy's Law.
You've done that? You shot climax at the beginning?
Yeah, man. That's the most worst thing you can do to yourself.
Yeah.
And
you tell everybody. Everybody knows who the killer is.
First days are always the most shittiest day, the most scariest day, and you have no clue what you're doing. And these two shit bricks, right? And one day we were shooting, and the first day of the thing, and Sir was on set, and he was giving his first shot, and his mic was on. And we were all shitting bricks, right? And Amitji was there. And Amitji is sort of murmuring to himself, "Arey yaar, ye pehla dena hai. Kitna saal ho gaya, abhi bhi mujhe itna nervous lagta hai." So we realized we are not the only one. Right. Here he is. So from that day, it was so much better.
Okay.
I think it happens to everyone across
yeah.
the
yeah.
board.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's true.
I thought we'd set some context. So I want to start. I want to ask each of you, what idea above everything else, what was that one overarching thought or that one overarching reason that you wanted to tell this particular story?
Who's going first?
So what's the question?
I think it's instinct, Rajiv. I don't know, man. It's like falling in love. Why do you fall in love? I don't know.
I suppose I'm asking what was it that you wanted to... What got you interested in telling this particular story at first go?
For me?
Yeah.
See, when I read that book, for me, it was an amazing love story. That's it. I always wanted to do a King Kong.
Mm.
So for me, this was King Kong. And that's it. I mean, nothing beyond this.
Well, that's an interesting one.
For me, it's survival. So when I signed Scoop, I had no work. So I read the book. I said, okay, I can, you know, you sort of imagine yourself you were coming
of
doing
scam.
This.
Yeah.
No, scam happened
right?
Oh,
okay.
Later.
Okay.
Oh. I signed this before that. Okay. And I was really out of work. So when the producers called me, said, we have this book. I read the first four pages. I said, this character is interesting.
Mm.
I had read about her. I said, I think I can do this, but sign on quickly so that I get some money.
Right.
You know, we were in the middle. The pandemic had just
as
begun.
As good a reason as any.
So, you know, sometimes you sort of push yourself into these things and then you make it you make it your own.
Your own, yeah.
Mm. You know, so I've learned to sort of, over the years, own things after, you know, you have to find a reason.
Mm.
So sometimes it's the story and, you know, you do all these films for the love of it. But always, you know, I find some reason. And most of the times it's survival. I need money.
Right.
So it starts with that and then slowly you start, you know, getting, it starts, you know, becoming part of your being. Sometimes when you're not really into it,
mm.
the project just falls through.
Right.
You know, the cracks start appearing and it just falls through. So, you know, it's 30 years have taught me that, you know, say no less. You know, try to say yes as many times as possible because, you know, you are just grateful that you're still getting work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was, you know, it was the judicial system, essentially, and like how broken it is and just how hopeless things are in a sense in this one story that was kind of inspiring in terms of how, you know, you just refuse to back down. But from a kind of creative perspective, the material just didn't present any opportunity in a way because there was no conclusion.
Yeah.
The case was going on forever. There was no kind of victory. There was no end. It was sprawling.
The
cases were complex. So I just sort of got into it and was like, okay, how would one tell this story? And it sort of forced us to do things in a very different way to kind of, you know, you can't show your antagonist. There is no ending. The main obstacle is like stagnation in the judicial system. So can you make a series out of this?
Yeah.
And that became an interesting challenge. And little by little, we got into it. And we did things we would never have done. And I think in some ways that kind of gives, you know, what your work a bit of character. It's like the things you can't do more than the things you can do.
Right.
So, and then, you know, it was just gratifying to sort of shine a light on those people and their struggles as well.
Yeah, it was so interesting that approach you took actually, you know, with different episodes shining a light on different aspects.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Lovely. And it was a tough because it's still ongoing. And even as we were shooting, it was like the judgments were changing. They were in, they were out, they were in, they were out. So.
And how did you decide what the ending should be?
We didn't really... So look,
it changed. I mean...
Yeah, so the thing is, like, her victory...
They were arrested, and then they were released. All this happened while you were still in production.
While we were still in production and while we were shooting, and then they were charged with tampering of evidence, which is a major, major thing.
Yeah.
But essentially, we realized very quickly that the victory or the climax or the big thing is that the family refused to back down. So the victory was not accepting defeat.
Right.
So we knew that was sort of the structure, and we wanted to end with that last image of someone just going to court, not heroic or anything, but just showing up every day, you know, and a normal person showing up and Yeah, and so that was it. But we didn't know that until the very end.
And also the incident you showed at the end.
We showed that.
Which was a great decision.
Yeah. We showed that at the end. Because we thought that, you know, once you know everyone, if you spend time
with them, because you have the context. Then so it's more meaningful.
For me, I think it was just the idea that the story, the world is going to be set in Andaman Nicobar Islands. It just got me excited. Oh, this is a place which a lot of Indians also don't even know that, okay, Andaman Nicobar Island is part of India. No. And the thought that it will have like a survival drama set in the islands. Why is it called Kala Pani? Because the context that we had, you know, and if people are stuck there, there's no way they can get out of that place. Just this whole world and the setting got us very excited.
How lovely.
And also something which we haven't done before. Yeah. So we knew that it's going to be very challenging. We'll have to push ourselves a lot, you know, to make this show. But yeah, we were up for it.
Nice.
I think it's a very brave, very, very brave show in the times that we are in. You know, and it's saying so much about the world we are living in. It makes so many comments. And, you know, when people ask me that, you know, censorship, does it bother you? Are you restricted? I tell them that, you know, you your expression needs to, you need to find a way to express yourself. It's not necessarily, you know, look at Iranian cinema, look at, you know, some of these brave things, the shows that these guys have made. You know, you're saying so much. Even in Scoop, I mean, we managed to, you know, say things that people thought would never happen. But we managed. I think it's, you know, more about intent and, you know, how you sort of find your voice, you you voice what you feel without really intending to sensationalize things.
Interesting. Rajdik?
We had to get out of the shadow of the family man. Otherwise, you're always compared with that work. And then you can never get to make anything else. You know, you're stuck in the same genre. Everybody wanted another family man. So it was, it's hard. We were just hoping that Farzi would work so that we could have two successful shows that I could now start making anything else I want. Even Farzi was off, very different from the family man. But Guns and Gulabs was just a freewheeling, no holds barred, fun ride.
Nostalgia trip.
We thought we earned it, you know, after being so working so hard on this. So we just wanted a just a fun, pulpy show that doesn't exist in the whole whatever landscape. And as audience, we love all kind of watching all kinds of cinema, right? So as filmmakers, we promised ourselves that we're going to make movies in all genres and doesn't matter. You know, keep be flexible, like do what you like. So Guns and Gulabs was
You should release your final episode with a little bit of editing as a film.
As a film, no?
It deserves a feature, a theatrical feature. You should do it. Do a limited theatrical release. Netflix, do it.
Why not? It'll be fun.
Netflix should be listening.
Dikit, do you have
Guns and Gulabs is also a, for us, like, I mean, like you said, it's a freewheeling, fun, you know, where we can express ourselves in many, many different ways. You don't have to be held back by the certain rules of the genre itself, right? So it's loud. There is this larger than life villains and everything. In a lot of ways, it's a throwback to us for our earlier work. Like we made 99. It was a fun film for us, crime comedy and, you know, crisscrossing twists and turns. And Shore in the City was, again, multiple stories impacting each other. So for us, it was a throwback to that, saying this, like, this one show where we're going to have fun. We're going to have people with seven lives and people who get shot and they get up and come back. And the retro element, people are going to be like, you know, in your face, Bollywood.
Just excited. It was very exciting when we put all this together, especially in the Family Man. Everything was subtle and organic, right? Even the camera, everything was very point of view, very dirty, organic, earthy. Music was minimal. We didn't want to dramatize. There are no slow motions. There is none of that in the Family Man. It's as real as we can do, running on the roads and stuff. This is widescreen, anamorphic lenses, big, you know, larger than life, fanfare music coming in. So good fun to do something like that. You need to do that to get it out of your system.
And music, right? All of us love the music from that era, and we wanted to have a lot of music in it. We got some in, but there's always a budgetary constraint, so you just can't get all the songs you want.
We ask for a lot of money also.
Too much these days.
A lot of money.
Some regulation should come there.
Really crazy. Every time you go asking for music, it gets more and more expensive.
Exactly. It almost looks like you can score two original songs
in that much.
By the time you pay for one song from the 80s.
Still, you can't it's so difficult to recreate that.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, those songs have that magic.
Yeah. True. Kankana?
You know, in Last Stories, what happened is that I was on the lookout for finding something to do with Last. And I heard the story, the seed of the story, I heard a friend telling at a dinner party.
Uh-huh.
And I just loved the reactions to it. You know, where this lady had come home and, you know, her bhai was, you know, in her bed. And, you know, that it, the reactions were pretty... God,
yes.
And, you know, disgusting and whatever. And I just found it so interesting because it's nice to, you know, in your story provide the context. That's what I was saying. That, you know, there's a bald fact and then you look at the fact with context. It changes everything. It gives meaning.
Yeah.
So I was really, I enjoyed that process. And how can we make it different? So you can, in a way, start the film as an Ishita, who's the employer.
Right.
And, you know, then kind of inhabit the world of Seema as well.
Right. Interesting.
Yeah. Very beautifully done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was hoping it was a dinner story, somebody said.
Yeah.
And somebody said, you know what, let me show the real person in it. Let me show a different perspective.
Thank you.
Sudeep?
So, I mean, I actually didn't want to do Kora first off when it came to me because I was just coming off Patal Lok.
Mm.
And I didn't want to do another investigative drama, you know. But, you know, I spent time mentoring these guys, you know, on the script, Kunjit and Digi. And I realized that it in tonality, there was something very different to, you know, it was something very different to Patal Lok. And it was possible to sort of, I could do a slow burn with this one. I could really drill down into relationships with this one, which in Patal Lok, because of the nature of it, I mean, it was really a macro look at things. We wanted to go sort of slightly deeper. And when that insight kind of came to me that it's really not a show about another murder.
Mm.
You know, it's really a show about relationships.
Yeah.
When that insight came to me, I was like, okay, now I'm in, you know.
Right.
And the other reason really was I had never shown on something not originated by me. And for me, it was just came as a challenge because I never thought I'm going to do it. You know, I always maintained that, no. I'll have to come up with the idea and come up with the, you know, with the basic thing. But then I took it up as a challenge that can I pull it off? You know, it was more of that really. It was a kind of a...
sort of challenge unto oneself.
Did you find that detachment helpful in a sense? Like versus, you know, when you create something of your own and like was there...
No, actually, you know, you spend enough time on something, it becomes your own. Mm. You know, it was really like that. So, I mean, by the time we got into prep, you know, I told these guys that I'm going to do the final draft of it, you know, and then, you know, because if I'm going to be standing on set, taking calls, I need to be very sure of why this line is there and do we need to shoot it or not? Do we need this particular shot or not? And all of those things. So, in the process, you kind of own up the material and it becomes yours, actually.
What was the scene that gave you the most anxiety?
I think for me it was, you know, we needed 8 days, we had 7. And we worked, I think, some 21 or 22 hours on that last day.
Oh.
On that final scene, which was between these two women at the vegetable vendor. And that is a scene that was rewritten right at the end, thank God. Because there was another character and we would never have finished, I think. In that sense, that did give a lot of anxiety because it was also on the road and so there was traffic and we had to finish other things and then get to that location. So that was difficult. You know, it's so interesting because ultimately what we retained was, you know, the most basic stuff where we were getting the emotions and the closes where we were getting the emotions.
Yeah.
Even though we shot it in so many different ways and got everything and whatever, but what we retained was actually just the essential stuff, which worked.
For me, it was, I don't know if you guys have ever shot a stampede, but it's frightening because that's one thing juniors do really well. He's like, you just, you know, so we had these in these staircases and said, okay, now go. And it was terrifying because it actually became a stampede and there was smoke and stuff and we thought people are going to die. And then no one can hear you say cut and no one can hear me anyway. So just like, so that was terrifying.
I don't know, man. In Jaane Jaaye, I didn't have much anxiety as such. I normally don't have those anxiety-filled scenes. But I think I remember once, long back, this is like Kahani times, we were shooting on a metro platform in Cal. And there was a scene where Shashwat had to throw, push Vidya onto the tracks, and the track was live, you know, and we only had about 5 hours to shoot whole sequence, you know, of her coming and pushing and everything, and we were just scared that if something happened, you know, we still have 30 days of shoot left. No, sorry, it was a very bad joke. It was a very bad joke. No, but that was really, not with Vidya or Shashwat, but like he was saying, the juniors are very good at falling off.
Right.
So you had to really, really, you know, apart from getting this scene done, you have to also make sure that, you know, it's just for the safety issue. Barring that, I don't think, much anxiety.
We had a jail in school. And when we went, it was a location in Baroda. We couldn't, in India, you don't find good locations for jails.
Mm.
So this was an abandoned, old court, which had become, 30 years back, there used to be classical music performances there, and it was in shambles. But somehow, my DOP Pratham felt that this is good. And it had to be cleaned, it had to be redone, and we didn't have enough money for it. So I had to trade off 2 days of shooting so that we could shoot there. So that 2 days I'd kept for reshooting, went into the jail. But we went then, I did not know exactly how. It was like starting all over again. It was almost towards the end of the schedule. It was like starting all over again because it was a new phase in the narrative.
Yeah.
You know, 3 episodes later, the show becomes a jail drama.
Mm.
It's a prison drama. So I did not know what note, what was the starting note.
Mm-hmm.
And there were junior artists from Gujarat, you know. So the cells were like totally packed, filled. There were kids there. Noisy children, and none of them, these are not the junior artists from Mumbai who work day in, day out.
They were trained, cinema
literature. These guys have just come and they've been put there. Great faces, but, you know, they look into the camera.
Mm.
And the first scene is supposed to happen there, you know, she's sitting there on her own. And I didn't know what would happen, how we are going to shoot it. So the first shot, suddenly you felt, I felt, you know, that we were entering into a bit of a hyper-real space. It was not, the rest of the show was, so it almost shifted genre there. And slowly I began embracing it, you know. So there was a scene where she's stripped. So then slowly all those things, you know, the it's something I'd never done before. Yeah. You know, getting little hyper-real with it, visually as well as, you know, in the performances. There was that little bit, you know, I pushed it a notch higher. And it was the first time I did it, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I enjoyed doing it. I just felt that the jail made me feel that I felt very, very claustrophobic in that space. There was no place to move the camera.
Mm-hmm.
There was no place. And I said, you know, don't make space for the camera. You know, don't have movable walls. Let the camera also get, you know, constrained and yet let it feel exaggerated.
Nice.
So it was difficult because I've never, I'm at ease, you know, when it's the family, like the Gujarati family for me is the easiest. You know, I do that every day over Thepla. But this was tough. I was anxious even after I edited it. This is, you know, suddenly it feels like this is a different me. But it's nice to explore yourself.
Yeah.
So on Kalapani, like, we had a lot of big sequences. I wasn't that anxious or nervous about those sequences. I was actually more nervous about a very emotional scene that happens in episode 3 where the husband and wife, they have an interaction and you know that the wife is going to die. And it's a very, very emotional scene.
Yeah.
And that scene was also very important because it kind of switches the tone of the show. No, till then it was all the setup that it's a disease that's spreading and there's chaos. But from there onwards, it becomes like an emotional journey of all the characters. And I knew that, you know, we had to get it right for the audience also to feel for these characters. So that scene had to come right. No, and these things, you know, they can be very easy also because you can get the actors only to emote once. I mean, they can't like cry out repeatedly, no. But at the same time, it also becomes challenging if we don't get it right at one time, then it becoming fake.
Mm.
No. So that was a very, very interesting and a very difficult scene, but it came out well. Again, on edit also, when I saw it, for the first time, I also cried Well, second time I kind of lost objectivity, and then when you put the BGM, and nah, it's not working. Yeah. Mm. Then after a long time, when I saw it again, I'm crying again. I think it's working. It's landing. So yeah, that was a very tricky
scene. Some silly things give you anxiety, like Bombada, Prasenjit.
Yeah.
We cast him, and his death is on a motorbike. He said, "I can't ride a bike." I said, "Shit." We never asked him that. And we can't change his death scene.
Yeah, this happens.
So Pawai, he is supposed to ride the bike, and so he came 3 days earlier to practice. And so he was riding like this, Bombada, superstar. Like this, very anxious. He's trying his best to be comfortable. So it took a lot of time. I mean, we, and you know, light, it, the DOP says, you know, we have half an hour. Half an hour, this guy is going to take to get onto the bike.
I think, but that's the biggest anxiety we have on set. Is Suraj ja raha hai, Suraj ja raha hai. Suraj ja raha hai, Suraj ja raha
hai. Lighting.
I mean, that's the biggest anxiety. Biggest,
yeah, yeah.
No, but that is something you get used to also now, I think.
Yeah.
Har roj, every other day, set pe hota hai.
Yeah.
Correct.
Rather than a specific scene, I'll tell you what kind of scenes that are most anxiety inducing, at least for us.
Yeah.
I'm sure a lot of people will also feel that is, there are some scenes that are written on paper that are already very good.
Yeah.
And when you know you have good actors, you just have to go, you do your job, and it's probably turn out to be a good scene, like a face-off scene or a conversational scene or a dramatic scene between actors, and you know it'll come out good. But there are certain scenes that are minimally written, typically action scenes, or typically, like for example, in Guns and Gulabs, there is a climactic face-off between Tipu and Atmaram, right? I mean, what do you write on paper? He sees him, he shoots him, and this happens, this happens, this happens. Mm. Now I think the pressure is on, how do you execute it?
Yeah.
How do you execute it in the best possible way, right? That's where the pressure starts building up. Mm. So you show up on set and everybody's now waiting because it's not clear. It's not clearly written. What's the shots? What's going to happen? How it's going to start?
Yeah.
Now you're starting to invent on set, saying, "Okay, first he comes here."
There's also mood and tone, right?
Huh?
Mood and tone is the main problem.
Mood,
you can't capture
tone,
it on
the
paper.
The pace and the execution, the specific shots,
right.
Like he shoots him, he flies off, he falls off.
Right.
So the number of pieces in it that will either all come together at the end of it, or not, is depending on what you shoot. I think those are the most anxious days.
Right.
And it's self-imposed.
Those instinctively, or do you storyboard and you just approach those instinctively?
Yeah, that's what I said. First day we do the shots.
And never again.
These are not storyboarded, man. Like once you're shooting for 60 days, 70
days,
on the 65th day, what storyboard?
Storyboard is
like you have to stop now.
Storyboard and short list.
I can't figure them out.
Also, because
it's really tough like that, just to.
Because also we're coming from, I still think we stick to our indie roots.
Mm.
Our independent roots where we can't waste a day.
Yeah.
Where I'll never, I don't think we ever reshot a scene. I don't think so. Maybe there's a couple of exceptions. So you have to get the scene right, period. Today is a scene, we do the scene. There is no plan B for us. So that's a self-imposed anxiety even now, I'm sure. Other filmmakers must be laughing, saying, "Haha, I shot it 3 times. So, but we're like, we've never shot a scene again.
Wow.
So now that's an extreme anxiety, right? Sun's going, light's going, the actor is not performing, somebody's forgetting lines, they want more time for lighting. All kinds of stuff is in play, but we have to finish the scene today.
Yeah.
So that for us is the one that gets us. I think we need to ease up on that and say, like,
and nobody else knows, right? Nobody else on set knows. Yeah. Isme 4 pages hai, abhi 2 pages ho gaya, 2 pages ho gaya. The first idea has no clue. He's coming and saying, "Sir, ab kya kare? What is happening next?"
Right.
He's like, "Okay, so he's gonna come from there and he's gonna be hiding here." We're just making it up. What's happening? And
we'll secretly ask each other, "Is this gonna work?"
I would even say that this is probably the core reason in Family Man, all these single shot sequences, I think this is probably the genesis of it. Because the first time we did it, we had the sequence, there are these boys in the van, they're going, and cops everywhere, and he gets shot. I mean, you can shoot it in many different ways. You could shoot it the spectacular Hollywood way with 10 cars and crashes and all. We don't have the money for it.
Yeah.
So we're not going to do any of that. So how do we make this most engaging, most interesting? And that's where I think we said, you know what, let's not leave the car. Let's stay with them. Let's do it as a single shot. And it kind of became a motif of the show, but that's where it kind of started as well. Mm-hmm. Saying, how do you execute it in a way that makes it unique and special?
Yeah.
Single shots are usually very tricky because, I mean, you don't want to end up like doing a jump cuts in the end.
Exactly.
On the edit, it's not holding up and it's not.
And sometimes single shot is also a trick. Yeah. I remember in Shahid, we had a riot sequence and the action director came and said, 4 days. I said, that 4 days, I have money, that all the money I have for the film will be over in 4 days. So I said, how do I tell him? You know, I don't want him to feel that I'm compromising. So I went to him, Master Ji, he's going to single shot mein karna hai. Ye single shot mein karna hai, to aap rehearse karo bahut. I'll give you time. So, bola aadha din chahiye rehearsal ka. So I said, aadha din le lo. So in 2 hours, the sequence was done. We had hidden cameras everywhere. So he said, ke, sir, ye to aapne bahut cameras bina shoot kiya. Ye single shot kaise hua? I said, aap nahi to 4 din lene wale the. To maine 4 camera laga diye. And 4, you know, Canon 5Ds. Hiding everywhere and, you know, shooting. Like, yeah. But it was live, you know, yeah. They were putting things on fire. Live.
It was action, yeah.
Yeah, people were people were set on fire. Mm. So it was all happening live. You know, sometimes being indie pushes you to be more creative. You know, the lack of resources is actually so empowering.
Creatively
very empowering.
Yeah. Imagine if they said you have unlimited budget. We'll never finish it.
And you'll I think you'll make some real terrible stuff.
Your instincts work better when you are under pressure. You know, when you have time constraint or
you think
better. You think
should we be saying all of this aloud?
It's not going to change.
Nothing is going to change. It's not like they were going to
happen. It will get less.
It's never
too much. I think it was the action climax of the. Of the show in the sort of the beginning of the 6th episode when Karundi goes to rescue Balbir from this place. We had something on paper which we went into prep with, but you have to get into prep and you finish it and you're like, no, it's not flowing for me. It's not working for me. This whole setup. And we actually did the scout, found those locations, and there's something which was not sitting right with me. And then, so I take opinions of most of the team when they read a script, no matter who that person is. So one of the, I think the production controller, she read it and I asked her, so what did you think? And she said, it's great, but I thought that thing was shit. And I was like, even she gets it, you know, and there is something wrong with it. I just knew it. So then, you know, it just, we sort of rewrote it and then found that one location just before the shoot. Until that time, I was not sure because it's not stuff you've bounced off, gotten feedback on. It was a biggish sequence, like a 5-day or a 4-day kind of a sequence. But then you sort of go by hunch that, okay, and something tells me this is better, you know, it's going to work. So that it gave me a lot of anxiety.
Let's talk about casting. Tell me, did any of you have to really fight to get the actors you wanted?
No. I mean, surprisingly, no. You know, and given that, you know, I wasn't working with any big stars or something, but that's one thing I would, you know, I felt really supported at.
Sure.
You know, they went by... they went by my choices, you know. Yeah. All of these guys were my first choices, you know. And there was never a like, no, you can't work with, you can't work with him. Or a term that I absolutely hate is cast up.
Oof,
you know, I hate it. I mean, every time I walk out of, I zone out of those meetings. When every time someone says, let's cast up, I don't know what that means, you know. So thankfully, there were none of casting up for this.
No, but I also mean, you know, fight in terms of scheduling that just didn't allow you to get the actor that you wanted. I mean, did you have to struggle to get?
So it was, you know, the struggle was to really find those actors, you know, because we had a lot of, we wanted to really cast from Punjab and find a lot of those actors. So, I mean, we had the casting director go to Punjab, spend a couple of months there, like travel to villages, go to theaters, do all of that stuff and find those, you know, find those people which we have not seen. Like my brief was that, I do not want Bombay faces because you get tired of them. Yeah. It's the same set of audition, left profile, right profile. You really get tired of, you know, watching that. So we wanted those faces. We wanted those characters. And that was the struggle, you know, in kind of, you know, getting to them. But once you see that, you know, audition, you're like, okay, great. You know, this is what we really wanted.
Now, speaking of struggle with actors, like in Guns and Gulabs, Gulshan Devaya almost did not do the show multiple times. It's like there's some reason or the other. He's like, oh, sir, I'm excited. Let's do it. And then suddenly something happens and like my other show, the dates are clashing all over. So I want to do that. And I've already committed, I've already shot half of it, so I have to do that, I can't do this. So we move things around, change things around, eventually get him to do it. Then he's like, but sir, I played villain roles too much. I don't want to play a villain role. I'm like, dude, this is not a villain role.
Right.
This is one of a kind role. Yeah. You'll be happy you played it. So the number of times that he almost didn't do it, but eventually ended up doing it, I'm sure he's very happy now that he did it, is, you know.
It's hard to imagine anyone else in that part.
We had to change the schedule around so much during the third wave of COVID.
Mm-hmm. Our challenge was mainly that, the third wave.
Yeah. Yeah.
And actually, the biggest challenge for Guns N' Gulabs was shooting in that bubble. There's no way you can do a bubble. Bubble is just a random name you use, that's all. Everybody was ready to catch COVID and everybody caught COVID. One off. So we had two people for the job. Two directors.
Yeah. You know,
starting with
two DOPs, two art directors. So, you know, we had backups.
Wow.
So Mukesh Chhabra and me, matlab, have always tried to, you know, be subversive.
Yeah.
You know, find. And luckily, Netflix supported that most of the time.
Mm.
When they didn't, we had to cheat. but, you know, like Karishma was, I saw her audition. There were many auditions. They were fantastic actors. Somehow I felt Karishma was correct.
Mm.
You know, she came with no pretense. And I told Netflix and they were on board. For me, you know, casting is, you know, more than 70% of my
job. Right, it's crucial. Yeah.
Correct casting. Yeah. Yeah. You know, casting all these people is amazing. Like Harman, you know, he was like the breakout of the show.
Yeah.
You know, and he himself, he was surprised with himself. You know, he gifted me this watch. He was so happy.
Anyone else? Did you have struggles?
Not struggles, but I mean, you know, the thing is, because of the pandemic and all, we had a very short period of time and dates and everything. You know, it's really tough when you sort of get a green light and then you're supposed to cast the show very quickly, you know, all of a sudden. But I think, you know, in the case of, you know, with Rajshri, for example, she, you know, she hadn't done a lead.
Mm, yeah.
But Netflix was very supportive. And I think what really worked is that she just killed it in the audition.
Yeah.
She very kindly did an audition and we taped it. It was all through Zoom. Everything was through Zoom. And it was so compelling and so powerful that I think that just sort of settled everything. But that was obviously the one where everybody was like, who are you going to cast? And the one where possibly they, you know, you would need to cast up, as you say.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the audition itself was so compelling that everybody was on board straight away. So
I guess, I mean, I have never worked with stars as such. So kind of Netflix knew that, no, I'm not going to come up with options. No, we'll be known faces. Mm-hmm. But they were very supportive. Like on a show of this scale, we got people who, and I wanted not really known names because that kind of helped the show, helped the characters, helped the story. And they were very supportive. They kind of let us do it our way. But we did got Ashutosh Gowarikar.
Yeah.
Casting up, I think discussions happen in every show, every film.
Yeah, I think it's also, we have to, you know, at times I put myself in their shoes. I said, okay. You know, they are trying, within their capacity, trying their best to help me make a better show.
Yeah.
You know, for the show to go wider, they're trying.
Yeah.
And you have to find that, you know, middle ground.
Yeah.
Both of you agree on things. I think
it's a
push and pull. You know, like Zeeshan came from Netflix. I mean, that idea to cast Zeeshan and such spectacular,
so good,
such a lovely actor. And Zeeshan is somebody who started almost with me in Shahid.
Yeah.
So, and yet, out of sight, out of mind, because Zeeshan has done so much work.
Mm.
So casting Zeeshan in that part was, and Zeeshan called me one day, he said, you know, sir, isme English bahut hai. I said, so Zeeshan, you are from bloody KMC. You know, you've done English literature, MA. Matlab, tu, why are you worried about English? Bola, nahi, my accent. He said, why do you need to sound like a Britisher?
Yeah.
This is not the crown.
Yeah.
you're not playing Harry.
Yeah.
you're playing, I said, just watch Hussein Zaidi on YouTube. And so he watched him, he said, sir, meri to isse achhi hai English.
Konkana, you'd have been great in any of the two roles in your film. Why have you stayed away from directing yourself?
No. Why will I take this on unnecessarily? Anyway, I'm doing acting. Otherwise, I mean, I'm primarily an actor. So, I get my fill there. I don't want to subject myself to that. Also, you know, when you're acting, then you're, in a way, you're loaning your body out to, you know, a character. And then when you're directing, you want to be able to, you know, wipe that sweat off, or, you know, just like whatever you need to do to yourself. You don't want to have to then worry about like hair, makeup and costume and things like that. I don't think I would torture myself like this.
But Konkana, really, you should be so more. You should be directing more.
Yeah, directing myself, though, no.
Ha, that's fine, but you should really be directing
more. You should also act more. I mean, we don't see
yeah,
you.
Guys, I'm also acting. Yeah. Yeah. These are directors.
Perfect place to make the pitch.
Yeah, just so you all know, I'm an actor.
Yeah.
You? VK is also pitching these days.
Yeah, me too.
Please.
Okay. Well, but yes, me too. Yeah, yeah.
Just so you know, I'm also an actor. Who you
seen your commercial.
I am also an actor.
Folks, this is the storyteller's round table.
These guys have rejected me. These Raj and DK.
Well, they didn't reject
you in Family Man.
You didn't have the range.
I even offered you a role. You were not
Fuzzy. No, you said you chickened out because Manoj told you that he's a bad actor.
Your reputation precedes you, sir.
Manoj matlab makes it a point to go and tell people he's very bad. Bahut bura actor hai. Bahut bura actor.
I had to watch you very closely in that commercial. Ki any expression is coming
out. I overshadowed Tigmanshu in that commercial.
Tigmanshu.
Correct.
Director.
You know, what is your approach to creative feedback? How do you take a note that you might disagree with?
We change the script on the set, like an entire. I'm being true.
Be honest,
we got an idea in Dehradun as we are shooting that, you know, hey, let's add a chase sequence here, because there was a funny chase idea of Tipu running back in his bike, and so that wasn't in the script. Mm. He just goes to look for Atmaram. And then he heads back. But we really felt there should be something exciting there. So we came up with a hilarious action sequence. It was not in the script. So somebody called, Tanya called and said, you're shooting action? I said, yeah. Where is the budget? I said, don't worry, we'll figure it out. And so we actually shot it for like 3 days.
We shot for like 3 days, a proper action sequence that was not in the budget, not in the script. And yeah.
No, but it's good sometimes, because that's OTT also gives you the space to experiment, I feel. So that was us actually trying to do more than what was there.
Right.
We did that earlier in The Family Man also. But we tend to push it. And usually the platforms and Netflix has been quite supportive in that, by the way.
Yeah.
I mean, this is not so much about Netflix. I don't want you all to be restricted by that.
No.
But how do you take notes?
Mm. I think you have to look for the note behind the notes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, yeah. So when people tell you that you know, there is something wrong with your script or your edit, they're always right. But when they tell you what is wrong with it, they're always wrong.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, because you have to find that out. You know, it's really about that. So when they tell me, oh, they're having some problem with, say, the third episode mein kuch ho raha hai wo gadbad hai, maybe it's the first episode which is a problem. You know, maybe you need to fix that, and then everything falls into place. So you really look for those discomforted issues, like,
right.
Okay, what is it that's bothering them? But find the answers yourself. It's a bit of that, actually. You know? Make them rewatch it, and somehow it feels like, oh no, it's working now. It works.
Right.
And I don't think you should
music came in.
Outrightly reject the feedback.
No, it's important.
I think it's important that you hear the point, because you are so close to the material that at times you don't have the objectivity, you know.
Yeah.
So but someone else telling you,
you have a doubt about something.
Correct.
And that only 2-3 people pick
correct.
Up. Maybe not
correct.
Exactly the same way,
correct.
But somewhere around
yeah.
it was the aspas.
Yeah.
And then, also vice versa, sometimes you know that this is
right. And it's also never a you have to do kind of a thing.
Yeah,
exactly. It's more like a suggestion, recommendation.
Yeah.
But see, the way we look at it is,
factors come in.
Besides us and the core people who worked on the show, the studio execs are the first people watching the show, correct? And so you have to look at it like audience feedback.
Yeah.
The first audience, smart audiences too. So you listen to them, and if they say something, you have to take it in broad strokes, like you said. You can't say this scene, this line. It's not
right.
They're saying, I didn't understand why he said that. That means, okay,
yeah.
Somehow there is a line that wasn't coming through clearly or something.
Right.
So you try to fix the problem like that. I even ask them the question sometimes when the feedback comes, like a lot of feedback comes or like specific thing. I'm asking, okay, are you saying this because you felt this as a viewer, or are you now putting your executive cap on and thinking that the audience will find this problematic or hard to understand?
Right.
And a lot of times if they say the answer is no, I'm thinking for the audience, I'm like, it's okay, let it be.
Yeah.
Then you and I are on the same boat. Like, I think the audience will get it, you don't think they will. Let's you know, put a pin on it. But if you say that you didn't get it,
I'll address
then
it.
Then I will definitely look at it.
Sure. Yeah. But Sujoy, I feel like surely there must have been someone that told you, you have to show what the teacher did with the body. How did you fight that?
I still get stopped over there and people ask
me. I mean before you put it out.
Yeah, I was at another panel with him where that's the question people wanted to ask him. What happened to the body?
Body guy. No, but that's the whole essence of the story. You see, this guy was giving you this whole fund on P equals NP, right? Where either you find the solution yourself or you accept the solution that has been presented to you to any problem. And this is the solution he presented to Vijay and the rest of the world. And as far as the world is concerned, the body is found. So how does it matter where the actual body is? So for me, that was the essence of the story. I mean, that was his victory was. So, and that's how it should be. People should believe that is the body because everybody chose to believe that is the body.
Did it take some convincing on your part to be allowed to do that, to get away with it?
With?
Netflix.
With Netflix. No, actually not. No, they were quite okay because... actually they were quite cool about it. But as long as... I think the only thing I got back from Monica was she wanted a little more clarity on the explanation, which we did.
Okay.
Which I think also helped telling the story a little better. Apart from that, there was no exact body udhar hai.
Okay. To all of you, what's it like watching the first lineup, the first edit for the first time?
I mean, I try to work with the same editor that I've worked on all my stuff with. And so now we very clearly said, you don't have to show me the version that I want that to write. You know, you don't have to prove to me that something's not working. So just save me that pain and and cut everything that doesn't work and then share it. And we know each other really well. We spend hours and hours, you know, like in the room together. So I don't see that version, actually. You know, I see the version that's already stripped of all the...
excess fat.
Yeah, so we try to jump that phase as much as possible because it can really be crushing, especially in the beginning. You know, when you're getting started. So thankfully that's my solution. Okay. I don't want to see it.
For me, you know, the first lineup I ever see is the most exciting part because I think till date, whatever good movies I've made has been made by my editors. Okay, they have made my film. And I think that's the most amazing part because I give them my rushes. I stay the fuck away. And they make a film. And that's the most exciting part. And I think that's the best thing that happens.
Wow.
But seriously, all my good films has been, whether it's Namrata, whether it's Monisha, whether it's Urvashi, they're the one who has actually made the film. You know, I've given them some rushes and they have actually made the story.
Right.
So you're not in the edit room with them through the edit process? You come like every now and then?
I come, I hang, I have a cup of tea, have an omelette sandwich. Yeah. All those shit I do.
And you...
But you let them find the film?
Yeah,
and they're amazing.
You have to.
We have some amazing editors in our country. And they're so good. And you have to let them be. You cannot go in there and tell them,
It's the same rule I follow. I mean, the one editor I have worked with, she's fantastic.
So
the first edit is always hers. The first cut is hers. And then, which I don't enter. I tell her I don't want to see anything. Even if she wants me to, I say, no, I don't want to. Just do your thing with it. And then I'll come in. And then you watch it. My process is I'll watch it twice. You know, which becomes difficult if you're like 8 episodes. You're like, okay, that's like 4 days of just that. So you watch it once. As an audience, you know, you're like, okay, I'm watching a story, you know, you do not wear your filmmaker hat. Then the second time when you're watching it, you're like, okay, you take a deep breath and say, okay, let's get to work. You know, and that's when the real work then kind of start. Then you're there for every shot, you know, for every hour of edit, you're there throughout for the next 3-4 months.
Yeah. I enjoy editing the most.
Yeah, it's fun.
I think editing is where...
It all comes together there.
And it's also, it's painful sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, you're seeing things that have not gone the way you intended. The editor has seen a scene very differently from you.
Right.
So you sort of, so it's very organic. Correct. It's a beautiful process.
It's rewriting.
It's a beautiful process. And I've, since the pandemic happened, I discovered cloud computing. Mm-hmm. And I haven't been to my edit. I met my editor last night. I met him after a year.
Wow.
At the awards, you know, and we had a drink together. So he's a young boy. I think he's not even 30, Amitesh. And he argues a lot with me.
Yeah.
He argues a lot. And all the argument is on chat, like, you know, there are comments. Mm. It's a populated, it's a application called Frame.io. Uh-huh. Mm. So, you know, where we upload and, you know, I swear a lot on it. This is fucked up. Look at that performance. Which take have you used? You know, so there's a lot of
back and forth
there. And his reply is, sir, that take was not good. He has very cryptic replies. So, but it's a process. You know, by the time it reaches Netflix, we are at a stage where, you know, we also feel convinced. It's important to fight constantly. Yeah, yeah. The editing process is where, you know, you can be a bit lazy that, oh, I've written it this way and keep it this way.
Right.
I mean, that is the worst thing you can do.
Yeah, right. Correct.
The greatest disservice you can do to your own story, to your own material.
I mean, they are actually creators. They are not technical people. They're not operators.
They're writers.
You can't tell them that, oh, put a cut here. That's the worst thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
When you're sitting with the editor and tell them, yeah, this is the place where I want the cut. I mean, that's his job. He knows it best.
Oh. I started my career as an editor. So I had directors, very senior directors, who used to hit me on the shoulder. I used to get hurt at times. Don't hit me. I'll cut.
It's very interesting to listen to everybody's perspectives. But we are one of our first films. We didn't like the edit. We tried our best to sit with the editor. And he wasn't doing what we wanted. It was a very slow moving thing when it's not supposed to be drama. It was comedy.
Who was the editor?
I can't name him. But you can figure it out.
But he was actually the editor of an Oscar winning drama.
Oh, wow. There you go.
He was also editing our indie film.
So we didn't. We tried our best to get in sync and it just didn't work. So we went and bought a machine and put it in DK's room and we started re-editing the whole film.
Wow.
So we both taught ourselves, and we knew by then, but we taught ourselves more. And we said, thank you. And we edited the whole film and that's our cut. We didn't put our names there. But so what, like I said, we went back to the fact that we taught ourselves all the aspects of filmmaking so that we're not dependent on anybody.
Right.
That's indie filmmaking, no. Right? So that works. So it's been going on. So we give very minute edits, by the way.
we'll tell you where
to cut.
Yes, that's his job to cut. If it is not what you want, you have to tell him. Add three more frames.
Eventually, that's what happens.
We even do we download files and we have it with us. So we even go back. I even go back in QuickTime 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and say 5 frames, please cut. So it is that precise. But we have a great editor now, Sumit.
Right.
Who's been editing from The Family Man to Guns and Gulabs.
Right.
So he's in sync.
Mm.
You know, he's every time winning awards and stuff. But he's in sync with us. Now we know it comes out nice. We know the first cut itself is great. He knows that I want music already. I want sound already. So they put everything in.
Right.
And otherwise, DK used to say, you don't watch first cut. Because I'll see the first cut and say, we're fucked.
Yeah.
Not happening. Midnight calls. DK will be like, no. I say, I think it's bad. This is the worst thing we have done. So I'm banned from watching.
The feeling.
Yeah.
Watching the first cut is always dreadful. Not because the editor is bad. He's good.
Yeah.
He's worked with us so much. But the thing is, when we're shooting, we're kind of thinking of the edit in our mind, right? So we already have a preconceived idea of how the edit should be. And if the editor, when the editor's cut comes, it's probably a little different. Maybe not the best take has been used, or maybe not the best way to start a scene.
Yeah.
Sometimes he's done better than what we anticipated. Great, I'll take it.
Yeah.
But it's always the problems you focus on, right?
Yeah.
So you're like, oh my God, oh shit, you
use fix this it
shot.
On that one little,
this shot. Oh no, it's terrible. Oh, that expression, no, bad. So by the end of it, you're focusing on the little 50 things that are bad and not focusing on the 500 things that are good.
Yeah. Right.
So you're like, okay, this is not good. Don't show to anybody. Mm. Let me give my feedback. After that only, it's like. So I think we're being a bit...
Yeah. I'm very nervous before seeing the first cut.
No, I mean...
I'm very nervous. But when I start seeing it, then I think by the end of it, it's a mixed bag of emotions because I know that certain things which I thought were working on set, okay, they're not working. We'll have to somehow make it work. But then certain things which were I thought are kind of not working on set, they have come together really well.
Yeah.
And that happens a lot of times. That on set, you were not too sure. But on the edit, when you look at it, you said, no, it's flowing well. So I guess by the end of first cut, you know that you are, you have some things right, you have some things wrong, and then now we can come together.
I think first feel better after watching, because, you know, my editor, I mean, she's great, but she hates everything. it's just that she hates everything, right? So every day it's like, this is shit. What are you guys shooting? This is. So you walk in thinking, oh man, like, I don't know what you've done. I don't know kya dekhne wale. And then you watch it, like, it's not that bad. Like, I don't know. I don't like it. Like, okay, we'll fix it. You know, but it's only a step up from there. Yeah. You know it.
I know Yeah, I really enjoy. I mean, of course, the first time it's, I think, nerve wracking because I'm so new in any case to the whole thing. So you're like, oh shit, I didn't take the shots. I don't have the shots. And that happened, the similar thing happened on my first film in Death in the Ganj. I think the first editor and I, we didn't really quite gel at all. And also, I'm editing while I'm writing.
Right.
Also, I have. So in that sense, and luckily, but I found, you know, two editors who I was very much in sync with really enjoyed the discussions in the room with them, just are so enjoyable because you are also rethinking what are you meaning to say, how is it coming across and all of that. It's great fun, but I'm also very involved. You know, I also want, no, we can't, we have to cut it earlier or whatever, show me so much or whatever it is, you know, and they've been very kind, I have to say.
To all of you, what was that time in your career when you felt like you were taking your biggest risk?
Biggest risk?
Biggest risk.
Twice for us. I mean, many times. Actually, every film is a risk. But first time, I'll make it quick. First time is when we did Shore in the City. And it was, you know, lauded everywhere. The great film, best film and all that. And we say, I want to do zombies now. So you're like, what? You're just throwing away all the serious filmmaker tag and saying some chutiyapa. You know what I'm saying? So that was a big risk.
Yeah.
We knew going in. We don't even know what it is like to shoot some random zombies in Goa. Right, so that was one. The second time was doing Stree, where we said, you know what, last film didn't work, and we're going too much of in the whole commercial route.
Yeah.
I want to go back to where we started, believe in that crazy idea, and we'll do it ourselves. We'll put our own money, we'll do it ourselves, just make it as small, and take that risk again to see, you know, your hero is not he's not the chosen one.
Right,
he's the son of a prostitute. Everything is off in that film. Nothing is like by the hero, by the rules. And there's horror and comedy. Usually you don't see them together. So again, we took that saying that after. So you usually go the other way, I think. I mean, you know, what work you see and say, try and redo that. So hopefully you'll get a hit. But this was more in uncharted territory, saying, you know what, let's just go to something that we really believed in, make that. And the third time we took was to do a series.
Yeah.
We had to put two films aside.
Right.
And said, I don't want to do films because it's okay. I want to do this new format that's really exciting. And everybody seems to be watching series, including us. The last time anybody asks you, what should I watch on TV? It's invariably a series recommendation versus a film. So wanted to do that. So we put away a couple of films to do The Family Man. Took a whole year to write it. Figure out your own how to write it. You don't know how to write a series, right? You have to do it on your own. So, yeah, I think all these were the biggest.
Yeah, and also the number of series also, right? I mean, once we did Family Man, next thing is to quickly start doing that. But we decided to do another series in an entirely different genre, because I guess somehow that's what we programmed.
Yeah.
It's like we've never done a sequel for a film before, till now, only, you know, now. So we're doing all these series before we come back to do the sequels, the season twos of those.
Well, for me, the biggest risk is being safe.
Yeah.
You know, the moment you feel that you're safe means there's something wrong.
Mm.
And, you know, you've got the biggest star possible. The story is like sure shot. For me, taking those risks, you know, there's a line in Scam, risk hai toh iske. And I think, you know, Rajkumar Rao was a risk at that time, perceived as a risk. Manoj Bajpayee as an old man was perceived as a risk. Pratik Gandhi was perceived as a risk. Karishma Tanna was a risk. And I think all those risks have, you know, just given me, it's you know, very, very corny when I say it, but it's like, you know, whenever I've not taken a risk, you know, I've made a Simran.
Yeah.
So, I hope to break that jinx also, you know.
Right.
So, So when, like, with Kareena, I've sort of subverted what Kareena has been doing.
Right.
Mm. You know, so unless you do that, you know, I find it very boring to land up on a set and feel ke, it's all very safe. I have a lot of money. I've got big stars. This is like this big commercial film. None of that actually works.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that the risk part of it is sort of intrinsic to what we do. It's like if you come on set or if you're writing something and you don't feel like there's a risk to it, somehow it, you know, it doesn't feel right.
That's
right.
Like,
yeah, there's got to be something that can't. Otherwise, also, what's the point? In a sense, you, that means you're repeating yourself or you're doing something that's. I think that I actually look for that part, you know. And if I if it's missing, then I feel like maybe I'm not pushing myself hard enough, or
I think for me it would be the time when we made Permanent Roommates, which was kind of probably India's first web series.
Yeah.
So before that, we were making sketches, you know.
Yeah.
And for the first time, we were exploring long form. And that time in India also, people didn't have the concept
of
series.
You guys are the OG. You're the OG long-form guy.
So we were very nervous whether people will accept this on YouTube, like putting out a 40-minute episode, will people watch it? So there was a lot of nervousness there. But yeah, it worked.
Yeah.
Again, it was just that we were trying to do something different.
Different, yeah.
The same happened with Kala Pani, because again, very different from what we had done before. So, yeah.
Go.
I feel the, I don't know what was risky. Everything is risky, as you were saying. But I, like, I think the story itself, like in Last Stories, was very risky. It was, it felt risky. It felt like too scandalous and it felt like too, I don't know. I mean, because I've never done work like that as an actor.
Mm.
So it felt risky, but just went with it.
Clearly paid off. Resonated.
Me? I think, I don't know if it's a risk. I think the biggest thing for me was Kahani. You know, everybody kind of dissuaded me at that point of time. You know, a pregnant woman running around in Calcutta. What are you thinking? And I think that probably was the biggest step of my career, you know, especially coming out of a mega flop, two mega flops, and then embarking to the extent nobody believed in the film, nobody gave me money to make the film. But that was good, you know, that I think what Hansel was saying, if you don't believe in something, then what's the point?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think that's the biggest risk I ever took in terms of making Kahani. It's worth it.
Yeah.
I've actually never felt like I'm taking a risk with anything that I'm doing, you know, it's like, you're telling a story, you know.
Yeah.
Risk is someone else's, you know. And really, your job is to convince them to give you the money, you know. Apart from writing and making something good, your other job is to convince them to give you the money. So the risk is theirs. I mean, I want to tell this story, you know. At best, I'll fail at telling this story well enough. And that's the risk. And that risk is there every time. But, I'm not plotting my career saying, I'm going to go from here to there to... You do what you feel like doing next, then.
Scam 1992 was a big risk when we made it, and because it was financial, there was jargon.
Very dry,
very supposedly dry, and rejected by all the platforms. No platform was willing to buy it. The same thing. There is response. So we felt almost in May, like 3 months before the release, we felt that life has come to an end, but history. You know, there was a new platform, somebody who just said, you know, we don't have enough shows, give us this.
Mm.
And, things changed for everyone.
Show sort of spoke for itself, yeah. Okay. I thought we'd end by asking you, if you could have dinner with another filmmaker, another storyteller, living or dead, who would that be? What would you ask him or her?
Living or dead?
Huh?
Said living or dead?
Yeah, living or dead.
I would first
ask how much talking to a dead man.
How much?
Very bad joke.
I would say Stanley Kubrick in the dead ones. In the living ones, I would say Paul Thomas Anderson. And what would I ask them? I mean, how do you do? What did you do? You know, how did you make all these fantastic films one after the other? You know. Kind of pick their brains on that. Kubrick especially. I mean, he was fantastic, you know. Yeah. Although as an asshole, but he was fantastic.
Okay.
Maybe we can ask him, was it necessary to slap all those people?
Yeah, I think you should bring that up.
Along with the desert, we can ask that.
For me, but I guess it would be Almodovar. And if it could happen in the early 80s with all his friends who made movies at that time, I'd take that. Yeah. And ask him, I don't know, I just, you know, so much to ask him, but definitely Almodovar.
Okay.
Any day with Steven Spielberg, you know, just how he has evolved, how he has stayed relevant and still making films. And I would also like to have dinner with Salim sir and Javed sir.
Yeah.
Their minds is just different.
They have the best stories.
They're the best storytellers. I just want to listen to them.
Okay. Sujay?
I think living, I would want to probably sit with Clint Eastwood. I just want to know, where does he get all the time? I want to know his time management. When does he get time to read all the books? When does he time to get to write? At 93, he's shooting.
Yeah, there's a picture.
I want to know what he eats. So I really want to know everything about Clint Eastwood.
A raw steak is probably what he eats.
Jovio, I'm
waiting. You'll probably end up speaking more about old age than filmmaking.
Done. I want to shoot at 93. So that's one. I think dead probably... Obviously, Ray.
Yeah.
I just need to know how.
Mm.
How he told those stories, man. That's all I need to know.
Okay.
And those two.
No, you didn't mean that pick one dead, one alive, right?
No, I meant
pick anybody in the world.
Yeah, it could be living.
You're not having dinner with Clint Eastwood, right?
No.
So neither are you with Hitchcock, so it doesn't matter. Dead or alive, so.
Raj,
I don't know, man. Lots of filmmakers. There are so many filmmakers that have inspired us over the years, and it'll be great if you can pick one per one day of the week. But I don't know. Right now, maybe Christopher Nolan.
Yeah.
I don't even know if there's a question to ask. More like just hear him speak for an hour.
Right.
Yeah, just see what he has to say and just hear his thoughts out. I think.
Mm.
Yeah, no, I don't have a specific list. I think I like to listen to any filmmaker because, we never been to a set till we finished the third film. So I've never seen anybody else's set.
Yeah.
I've never seen anybody else's writing process. Yeah. So we don't know how others work. Still, I haven't been not enough sets. I don't know. I'm always curious when somebody comes from another set. I'll ask him, how was it? What do they do? How many takes do they take? How do they shoot? What do they discuss? How do they have shot division?
Yeah.
I do ask all these things, even if I would sit with Hansel, anybody here, if once we start talking, that's what I want to know.
No, sure.
Because I've never been through that process. So for me, any filmmaker's process is fascinating.
Mm.
And there's always something to learn. Because I'm always looking for tips and those hacks as to how do you write? What do you think? Where do you take it from?
Is there an easier way to do it?
Yeah, anything. Anything helps. I love reading those books. More than filmmaking books, I like to read... when these people talk about their process,
right.
The writers and the directors, and they talk
like their interviews or like their.
So those are interesting for me because it's nice to learn. There's constant learning at the end of it. So
Okay. Answer?
I would go with. I would go with Truffaut because that's one of my favorite filmmakers, and I would just like to shadow him for a day, and see just see how he works and why he took the decisions that he did. And also, I would say Shottajit Rai, because he also feels so from my world.
Yeah.
And just so tantalizingly close, but so far. Yeah. So I would also love to have dinner with him.
Yeah,
we will.
Dinner for three.
Troika,
My favorite guy is John Woo.
Yeah.
I'd like to spend time with John Woo.
John Woo?
Yeah, I love John Woo. I'm like a huge fan. I just saw a recent interview and in the New Yorker, about what he wants to do. There's about a film called Red Cliff that he made.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated. You know, there's so much artistry in what he does.
Yeah.
And yet, it's all very pleasing, crowd-pleasing. You know, there's action, there's all those things. I'm really fascinated by, I keep revisiting his old films.
Nice.
You know, so John Woo... I want to spend time with Wong Kar Wai. These are people I really feel like spending time with Hrithik Ghatak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I really find, you know, there's something in his work which is so imperfect, and it's so beautiful because of that.
Mm.
That I want to see where, you know, that angst. He's not shackled by craft. Mm. You know,
yeah.
He's so unshackled in what he does. And I mean, you know, I think he'll be fun. You know, it must be very irreverent.
Yeah. How lovely. I feel like these really give us an insight into the filmmakers and the films that have shaped you and your process. But thank you for sort of so generously sharing why you do what you do and how you do what you do. I hope that this really benefits other filmmakers and other storytellers who want to follow in your footsteps. Thank you for the incredible stories that you told this year. I feel like it was a little bit of an imbalance this year. We only have one woman at the table, and I know that there'll be more in future. But thank you so much. Looking forward to all the other work that you're going to do. Thank you for really sharing, opening your heart and sort of allowing us into your process. Thank you, and looking forward to everything that you do next. Thank you.
Thanks for having us. Thank you.